Hello everyone. Today we are going to review a book titled The Body, A Guide for Occupants by Bill Bryson. Talking about the book was supposed to unravel the mysteries of human body and help understand why the human body was built the way it is and what are the things that one should and should not do to live a harmonious life with this body. The author Bill Bryson is also the author of the book that you might have heard, The Short History of Everything. But moving on to the summary quickly, the very good thing about the book is that it gives you a lot of facts and interesting facts about the human body from top to bottom. It takes you through every inch of the body and the organs that are involved in the proper functioning of the human body. The downside of the book is that for people who have learnt biology in higher secondary or through any other mode, you would find 50 to 60% of the book as a repetition. The rest 30-40% is still to be explored. Well, that is the downside of the book. Now moving into the summary. He starts off with an interesting note around what are the things required to build a human body from scratch. Let's say if you venture upon an effort to build a human body from scratch, then what are the things that are required and how much would it cost you? Now there are these known elements that you might have heard about: carbon, nitrogen, hydrogen, oxygen, etc. and all of that, which make the human body. But the interesting fact is there are some rare elements also which he talks about, which are part of, which are in very small proportion in building the human body. Then he moves on from skin, head, the lungs, stomach, liver, etc. He goes from top to bottom, like I said, talking about each of these, the functions of each of these parts and what are the things that you should do to take care of each of these organs. The interesting part about the book is that he goes back into the history of medicine to understand how our understanding of each of these organs unraveled from history, starting from very crude ways of cutting the human body into pieces and understanding what is inside it, or how it worked or how it functioned before the advent of x-rays or the new ways of understanding the inside of the human body. Before all of that evolved, how did we understand them? It starts from there and it ends up to the way we understand each of these organs today. Now, for example, if you see our understanding of blood as an entity in the human body did not get into a very solid case until the start of the century. In fact, our understanding of blood transfusion or the blood types, etc., weren't so great, which meant that if people had bleeding problems before that, they would probably die of bleeding. There was no other mechanism or method to stop the profuse bleeding or to transfuse more blood into the body. And there is also this funny thing of people doing voluntary bleeding to cure diseases. So our understanding of blood was not so great until 100 years back. Right? Which means these field of medicine continues to evolve and it is evolving even going on from now as well. There are a lot of portions in the book where he talks about our understanding of a lot of these organs are still not open to the wide world. They are still being researched. That's the fun part. Now while talking about human body, the one other thing which he continues to stress upon that we cannot ignore is the microbial world that lives around us as well as within us. Now within us, we might have heard of the gut bacteria, the bacteria that live in the stomach that help us digest food properly, absorb food properly, etc. and all of that. See, he touches upon that and how we as humans understood them over a certain phase. Now if you see initially, it is not just about the bacteria which is within us, the bacteria which is around us also, our understanding of them also has evolved over a period. Initially, we did not know them, then we tried to understand them better, then we tried to mitigate them and fight with them. Now we have reached a stage where the bacteria is fighting back with a lot of resistance. Now, how are we going to handle that, etc., is all for open for question. Basically, if you see the death rate of humans because of viruses, bacteria, it used to be very high in the early part of the century or before. It has started to come down significantly, but the death rate because of our lifestyle changes has gone up significantly. That is the point he wants to emphasize. While he talks about all the organs in the body, etc., one part which he spent a lot of time discussing about is the heart in particular. Of course, it's a critical organ for our for us to live happily. But we don't appreciate the kind of effort a heart goes through in a human's lifespan. Imagine the heart has to pump the blood from about your chest to the toe. And it has to pump with such force that the blood goes and hits the toe and comes back to the heart against the power of gravity. Now, imagine the kind of pressure that it has to go through, and it continues to do that throughout our lifetime. But we don't appreciate it, and we continue to put a lot more stress on the functioning of the heart by having a very poor lifestyle. In addition to describing about all the organs, etc., he also breaks some of the myths that we generally have about our human body and the functioning of them. Some of them are hearsay, some of them are even prescribed by doctors as well. And it's funny that he says none of them are scientifically proven. Say, for example, the amount of water that one should consume, I think it's around 5 to 6 liters per day or something, I don't know the exact number, but that sounds to us like a proven fact. But actually he says no, it is not proven. And similarly, for example, he talks about the free radicals and antioxidants and how it avoids aging, etc., the green tea phenomenon, and people are taking supplements as antioxidants to help avoid aging. But the author talks about all of these things, and he says these are of course present in papers in the 1940s, 1950s, or whenever they were presented. This is all there, but if you go deeper into it, you will realize that there is not a lot of scientific data backing behind these research papers. They just scratch the surface, and pharma companies or the marketing people have just taken it up and built a business around it, is the point he wants to convey. The other point he talks about is that the human body, if you see, was built with a very simple objective. This whole structure was built to help a hunting human, right? A human who would scamper around 12 to 14 hours in a day looking for food and water. And the organs and the whole physique is built to help that objective. But we today sit in a corner, keep munching food than we actually need, and do a lot of mobilization. And we expect the organs of the body to function 100%, which is a sad thing. Now, there are other portions of the book where he goes into specific functions of the body and the diseases that they garner, etc., and all of that. I'm not touching upon all of these things for paucity of time. Now, what are the key takeaways from this book? Our understanding of the nuances in the functioning of organs in the body is very, very poor. Had we understood them better, it could have, or it will, help us take care of them better and help maximally utilize the functions of the organs. That's an important point. The second point is the need to lead a fit lifestyle is very, very important now than ever in the history of humans. Why? Because evolution has still not understood that we have abundance of food, and hence the inherent nature of humans to store food when they see a lot of it continues to remain in our genes. And hence, we need to start leading a much more prudent and fit lifestyle. Third point is the appreciation for research/scientists has to improve a lot. That the kind of effort that goes into understanding the unknown world within the body as well as the microbial world is much less appreciated. We take a lot of it for granted. A lot of scientists were awarded Nobel Prizes much later after their death because the generation at that point in time did not understand the influence, the insights that these scientists brought on human well-being. With that note, we come to the end of this week's book summary. I'll catch up with you next week with another interesting book. Till then, goodbye.